got a minute.
Get started in a minute. Yeah, my computer is booting up some power. That's iffy right now. I'm going to do the one.
I'm going to get started until you do that. I like that. The dress.
Thank you.
Very nice.
No look going today.
Good morning. Morning. Welcome to First Church of Lombard. My name is Val Sutton. I am the Director of Educational Ministries here. We will begin our service this morning with a musical prelude. Please use this time to center yourself and prepare yourself for worship.
Good morning and welcome to First Church of Lombard, United Church of Christ. We may be having technical difficulties, so if you didn't get a bulletin, make sure you snag one, because we might not be showing you things on the screen, but we'll see. Again, welcome to First Church of Lombard, United Church of Christ, however it is you're joining us for worship today, whether it's here in person or online. We are an open and affirming congregation, and as a just peace congregation, we're striving to live out the great commandment to love God and to love our neighbor. Through heartfelt worship, faith exploration for all ages, loving, caring relationships, and acts of service and justice, we seek to be a faithful community where individual faith journeys are honored and critical independent thinking is valued. As always, children are welcome in worship, although our nursery is closed for the time being. We do have rocking chairs reserved in the back for families who have small children and want to be in the narthex in a quiet corner, where we've got some toys and books that will keep little hands busy during worship. We also, in the back this summer, for children and adults, you're invited to take part in our coloring project at the back of worship. And you'll see some of these completed works of art hanging there by the windows. And those are done by you and everybody. In our bulletin this morning, if you see an asterisk, that means if you're able to, in mind or spirit, please stand. Beginning on Rally Sunday, September 10th, worship time will resume at 10:15. Sunday school and confirmation will also resume this day as well. Also next Sunday, the 10th, is our worship service will be held outdoors, weather permitting, followed by our Rally Day potluck picnic. And so we're hoping you can join us for kicking off our program year. Hot dogs and drinks and desserts will be provided. We're going to ask you, if you can, please bring a side dish to share. Signups can be found on the bulletin board in the foyer or online using instructions in news and notes. At this time, please stand and greet each other for the passing of the peace. So please join me in our gathering song. Guide me, O great Redeemer. Thank you. Please join me in the opening prayer. Loving God, we gather before your presence today, hearts open and spirits lifted in humble reverence. As we lift our voices in praise and open our hearts to your word, may we be reminded of your faithfulness, our history, and in our own lives. May this time of worship be a testament to the strength of our faith, a faith that believes not seen and trusts for the fully comprehending. Amen.
Our scripture this morning is from the book of Judges, chapter 3, verses 12 through 30. The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord strengthened King Eglon of Moab against Israel, because they had done what was evil in the sight of the Lord. In alliance with the Ammonites and the Amalekites, he went and defeated Israel, and they took possession of the city of palms. So the Israelites served King Eglon of Moab 18 years. But when the Israelites cried out to the Lord raised up for them a deliverer, Ehud, son of Jarah, a Benjaminite, a left-handed man. The Israelites sent tribute to him to King Eglon of Moab. Ehud made for himself a sword with two edges, a cubit in length, and he fastened it on his right thigh under his clothes. Then he presented the tribute to King Eglon of Moab. Now Eglon was a very fat man. When Ehud had finished presenting the tribute, he sent the people who carried the tribute on their way. But he himself turned back at the sculptured stones near Gilgal and said, "I have a secret message for you, O king." So the king said, "Silence!" And all his attendants went out from his presence. Ehud came to him while he was sitting alone in his cool roof chamber and said, "I have a message from God for you." So he rose from his seat. Then Ehud reached with his left hand, took the sword from his right thigh, and thrust it into Eglon's belly. The hilt also went in after the blade, and the fat closed over the blade, for he did not draw the sword out of his belly, and the dirt came out. Then Ehud went out into the vestibule and closed the doors of the roof chamber on him and locked them. After he had gone, the servants came. When they saw that the doors of the roof chamber were locked, they thought, "He must be relieving himself in the cool chamber." So they waited until they were embarrassed. When he still did not open the doors of the roof chamber, they took the key and opened them. There was their Lord lying dead on the floor. Ehud escaped while they delayed and passed beyond the sculptured stones and escaped to Sarah. When he arrived, he sounded the trumpet in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went down with him from the hill country, having him at their head. He said to them, "Follow after me, for the Lord has given your enemies, the Moabites, into your hand." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, that is quite the Bible story, wouldn't you agree? The story of Ehud is one filled with so much violence and gore and poop jokes that you might be wondering if I went to Google and searched for the least likely passage in the Bible to preach about. And you'd be right, because that's exactly what I did. I searched least used scriptures for sermons, and up popped the story of Ehud the judge. I figured this way, this is the best sermon you've ever heard on this topic. Was this familiar for any of you? Well, chances are low, I know, unless you have been in one of my fourth and fifth grade Sunday school classes, where I teach from this story on a regular basis. You see, the story of Ehud is filled with lots of blood and guts, literally, and thus makes it perfect to capture the attention of young boys in particular. But the main reason I use this story is that it perfectly illustrates something I call the cycle of judges. Allow me to give you some historical context here. It's what I'm known for, after all. So the biblical book of Judges takes place shortly after the Israelites have returned from being enslaved in Egypt. They enter the promised land and they divide the land into 12 areas, each named after the ancestral sons of Israel. They were literally the 12 male offspring of a man named Israel, 12 sons of Israel. So each tribe settled into their area, and they more or less ruled themselves, unless the entire kingdom, all 12 tribes, needed to unite against a common enemy. And we find in the book of Judges that this ends up happening fairly often. In fact, it happens so often that a pattern began to emerge, a pattern I call the cycle of Judges.
Huh? See?
It is as easy to remember as A, B, C, D, E. First, and we see in this story, the people abandoned God. Just making sure it's working. Sure enough, all right. I'm going to trust the clicker. The Bible here says the Israelites again did what was evil in the eyes of the Lord. So it's again. This is not the first time. We don't know what specifically was the offense against God, but the key here is that the action all kicks off with the letter A, for abandon God. That's what the Israelites have done. Then, as a result of the abandoning God, we get the letter B, for bad things happen. In this particular case, the tribe of Moab partners with other enemy tribes and invades the land. This leaves the people under the rule of an enemy king for 18 years, forced to pay tribute, that is, taxes, to a king named Eglon. Bad things have happened. We don't know much about Eglon, except that his name, which translates to fatted calf. And it turns out that this name is fairly accurate, as he is also described as being very fat. Now, please note that this description is not used to humiliate Eglon, but rather to help the listener start building a picture of the scene in your mind. Can you just kind of picture this king, this little fat king? So because the people abandoned God, bad things happened. And after 18 years, people finally think to cry out to God, and there's our C. And because God hears the cry of the oppressed, God shows up. God sends a deliverer. There's the D for you, right? Now, when you read through the Old Testament, and especially in Judges, you learn that there are two kinds of deliverer that God would send to rescue the people when they would cry out to God. So, all right, we don't have that slide. Hold on. There we go. So God sends a deliverer. If it shows up later, we'll know. Okay, so there's two kinds of deliverer that God might send. So the people abandon God, bad things start to happen, they cry out to God, and God sends a deliverer. That's where we're at. Okay, so God would either send as a deliverer a judge or a prophet. Now, obviously, the stories in the book of Judges are about judges. But so judges are military leaders who would unite the country, unite the 12 tribes, and rise up against an enemy power. Judges brought God's judgment upon the enemy. Ehud, the hero of this story, is a judge. Honestly, the people preferred judges, because the alternative deliverer is a prophet. A prophet would save the day and deliver the people, but they had a different approach. Instead of attacking the enemy, a prophet would point out what the people had done wrong. What a fun person to be. A prophet spoke God's words to God's people, and what they had to say usually wasn't very popular or comforting. There are 17 books written by or about prophets in the Old Testament. And the common thread here is to tell the people what they did wrong. A prophet's main move was to say, "Hey everyone, repent and stop breaking God's laws." Not a very popular sentiment, as you can imagine. But in this story, in the story of Ehud, God sent a judge, which really does make for a more exciting story. As I tell my Sunday schoolers every time I teach this story, the stories in Judges could all really be envisioned as comic books or superhero stories. Every one of them has a hero that is somehow able to conquer the bad guy in some wildly over-the-top way. You guys know the story of Samson, the super strong guy with the long hair? That's from Judges. That's the sort of thing that happens in this book. So Ehud has a superpower. He is left-handed. Well, where are all my lefties at? Oh, we got a couple. Awesome. All right. I mean, it is a superpower, right? I mean, sorry, not right. It's a superpower. Left? The truth is, at the time of the story, that the time of this story was written, that couldn't have been less true. History has been unkind to our Southpaw brothers and sisters, with the left hand historically being associated with trickery and underhanded behavior. Of course, today we understand that to be a grossly unfair generalization, patently untrue in most cases. Both my best friend and my boyfriend are lefties, and I have almost forgiven them for it. But that was the context in which this story was told. But wait, there's more. Ehud was a Benjaminite. Get it? Okay. It means he was descended from the son of Israel named Benjamin. Still nobody? All right. It's actually a bit of a joke because Benjamin means son of the right hand. So for a Benjaminite to be a left-handed man, okay, it's a little bit of a punchline. It's kind of funny for Bible humor. That's all I got. Now, I know that for Eglon, we got a really strong description. He's a fat dude, right? We got that. But for Ehud, we only get left-handed. So to help you all envision that part of the story, I decided to look up left-handed swordsmen on Google. Now, of course, there are very few surviving photos of an ancient Israelite military leader. Instead, of course, what came up was Inigo Montoya. That is why he is on the cover of your bulletin and up here on the PowerPoint today. Now, many of you probably immediately got the reference, but for the few of you who have not seen The Princess Bride, allow me to explain. Inigo Montoya is one of the heroes of the 1987 fantasy comedy, The Princess Bride. He claims to be the world's best sword fighter and proves as much by fighting not with his right hand, but with his left, showing that he can best almost everyone even without using his dominant hand. So a search for a left-handed sword fighter left me with Inigo Montoya as played by celebrated actor Mandy Patinkin. So from here on out, feel free to imagine Ehud as Inigo Montoya when we were talking about Ehud here. All right, so this left-handed man somehow proves himself worthy of being chosen to carry the tribute to King Eglon of Moab. The choice was actually almost definitely a slight to Moab, kind of a quiet insult to Eglon that was likely to go unnoticed unless Ehud made a scene. And boy, did Ehud make a scene. The Bible is very specific here, telling us that Ehud straps a sword to his right thigh. This allows him to approach King Eglon fully armed, as the customary place to put a sword was on your left thigh, so it can be drawn with your right hand. Okay, everybody think this out. If you're using your right hand to draw a sword, you're going to go to your left thigh, right? Right? But if you're left-handed, you'd keep it over on your right. It would never have occurred to the guards that anyone would send a left-handed man to stand before the king. So they didn't bother checking his right thigh for weapons, just his left. And thus what had been seen as a disadvantage in his culture becomes Ehud's greatest strength. What happens next is more or less an onslaught of gross-out humor. Ehud gets Eglon alone in, of all places, the bathroom. That's what the cool roof chamber was. He then pulls out his left-handed sword, surprise, and says something like, "Hello, my name is Ehud the Benjaminite. You killed our ancestors, prepare to die." And things get real gross, real fast. Ehud stabs Eglon, sorry, I'm using my right hand, until the fat closes around the sword. Gross. It's really gross. The Bible even tells us that Eglon poops himself. Sorry, the dirt comes out. Come on. Ehud escapes somehow, aided by the fact that Eglon's servants assume that their king is on the toilet and are embarrassed to disturb him. By the time they decide to check on him, Ehud is long gone. Now that the people of Moab are thrown into disarray by the death of their king, Ehud is able to unite the 12 tribes of Israel and bring God's judgment upon the Moabites, releasing the people from 18 years of occupation. And sure enough, everything is okay again. So we got our cycle here, right? The people abandoned God. Bad things happened. They cried out to God. God sent a deliverer. And the last part of that, everything's okay again. Everything is okay again. So the story of Ehud very clearly illustrates this cycle, which happens again and again and again throughout the book of Judges and really throughout the entire Bible. But other than being an excellent illustration and example of this feature of the historical record, why in the world would I choose the story of Ehud to preach on this morning? Why choose this violent and vengeance-filled narrative for a loving and peaceful crowd, a just peace church full of people just trying to learn something about God without bathroom humor thrown into the mix? Because there's one more piece of context that I think helps bring this story home for us today. You see, this story, with all its humor and drama, was more than likely almost entirely a legend. I say almost because there's a chance that some of the historical details are correct. The occupation of Israel by the Moabites, the timing involved. But most of the fun and almost slapstick details were almost probably written for effect. And what effect could the writers of this story been going for? Believe it or not, this is not a story that exists to warn you to check the bathroom for left-handed swordsmen, although I do recommend doing that. It's not even a story that advocates violence against foreign enemies. Remember, prior to only a few hundred years before the Common Era, very few people had written texts, and as few people could read those texts. Most of these stories were told for years around a fire in an entirely oral format. Details, both funny and memorable and yes, gross, were added over time until they became sort of facts. Now, we experience this ourselves. Can anyone tell me what is the name of Paul Bunyan's ox? Babe the blue ox, exactly. So most of us know this fact, despite it being pretty much entirely a fabrication based on some vague idea about celebrating the spirit of the pioneers or something like that. So the final bit of context here that we need to understand this story and its place in our world today is when it was written down and for what reason. Many centuries after the events of Ehud the Judge and the attack upon Eglon, the people of Israel once again found themselves under the control of an enemy power, this time in Babylon. Then the Medes came in, then the Persians, then the Macedonians and the Greeks and the Romans. So this conquered people gathered and began to write down their history and their songs and their stories in an effort to preserve their culture. To these people in this time, the cycle of Judges was of all things a comfort because it reminded them that although they may seem stuck on B for bad things happen, it is a cycle. Again and again we learn a deliverer will come. These stories of deliverers reminded the people that everything will be okay comes next. But this was also a warning, because it is when everything is okay, when we feel like we don't even need God, that we abandon God and start the cycle all over again. Much of the Bible, especially the Old Testament, seems scary and violent when removed from context. But even a tale as graphic and visceral as the story of Ehud makes sense as a campfire story told to generations of fourth and fifth grade boys before finally being written down many, many years later, poop jokes all intact. It makes sense as a way to remind people that a deliverer will come, and that deliverer may not look anything like you expect. He or she might even be left-handed, God forbid. Ehud's grisly plan of assassination was in many ways ingenious, yet the high number of fortuitous circumstances and coincidences that were required to make this plan effective suggest a divine hand working behind the scenes to ensure success. Ehud just happened to be the one chosen to carry Israel's tribute to Eglon, and just happened to be allowed to have a second audience with the king. Ehud just happened to be left-handed, and the bodyguards of the king just happened to not check his right thigh for a sword. And Ehud somehow fortuitously found the time and the means to escape undetected. When the Israelites, under the rule of a succession of enemy tribes, looked back over the stories of their ancestors, they found comfort in these ancient tales of deliverance to come. Likewise, when we look back over our own lives, may Ehud's story lead us to consider whether the seemingly chance encounters, fortuitous opportunities, and timely coincidences we have experienced may have had a divine hand at work in them. It may be difficult to know at the time of the events themselves, but time and hindsight sometimes allow us to look back and trace a divine plan at work, sometimes faintly and sometimes quite clearly. Amen. Oh, there it is. At this time, you are invited to think about how you might give back to God this week. Donation boxes to drop off your contributions were available on your way into worship. You may give online on our website or by mailing or dropping off a check to the church office. Thank you for your generous giving of your time, talents, and treasure to continue the ministry of First Church. I will begin our time of prayer by reading the prayer requests we received this week. We hear statistics of Chicago murders all the time, but rarely do we hear their names. Just because they are anonymous to us does not make them anonymous to our God or to their families. Let us hear the names of those who lost their lives in the past week in Chicago due to violence. We pray for Edvin Augusto Gabriel Miranda, Jerry Devante Carter, Tiffen Johnson, Damon Taj Russell, Sir Carl Moman, Leroy Dean, Shaquille Bryant, Michael E. Roberts, and two unidentified men. Let us pray. Loving God, we come before you in prayer, humbly lifting up our hearts on behalf of those who are in need. Just as Ehud, guided by your wisdom and courage, delivered the Israelites from oppression, we seek your intervention and guidance in the lives of those facing difficulty today. Lord, may your perfect will be done in each situation. May your love, grace, and deliverance be experienced by those we lift up in prayer. Empower us to be vessels of your mercy and instruments of your peace in the lives of those around us. In the name of Jesus, who conquered all challenges and brings victory to those who trust in him, we pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise for the singing of our parting song, O God, our help in ages past. As we live out our stories, let us trust that God's transformative power can shine through even the most unlikely of heroes. May we go forth with open hearts, willing to be surprised by God's unexpected heroes and God's unfolding plan for our lives. Please be seated for the postlude.